Good evening. Welcome to South Asia Newsline. I'm Lipakshi Khurana. Here are the top stories we're tracking for you on Monday, the 21st of October. Pakistan violates ceasefire along border in India's Jammu and Kashmir. US Defense Secretary, House Speaker meet Afghan President in Kabul. And four killed in Bangladesh over Facebook post. And now for all the details. Pakistani troops continue to violate ceasefire in Poonch district of India's northern Jammu and Kashmir on Monday. No casualties were, however, reported in the incident till the last reports came in. This came after at least two Indian Army soldiers and a civilian were killed in Pakistani firing along the border on Sunday.
Heavy shelling by Pakistani troops destroyed several houses in the border area of Tangdhar sector in Kupwara district of India's northern Jammu and Kashmir late on Sunday night. Villagers on Monday said they were woken up by the shelling around 11 in the night and they scrambled to reach the bunkers to take shelter. Shelling continued for several hours in Tangdhar, in which reportedly two soldiers and a civilian were killed. The Indian Army also retaliated to the firing.
निकले तो पीछे से शेलिंग स्टार्ट होगी सर तो सीधा मकान के ऊपर गिरा के सर तो सब कुछ खत्म हो गया डॉक्यूमेंट्स वगैरह सब कपड़े वगैरह सर कुछ नहीं है फ्रेंड्स वगैरह से कपड़े लिए हमने सर पहनने के लिए
दिस केम आफ्टर द इंडियन आर्मी ऑन संडे सेड दैट इट हैड डिस्ट्रॉयड टेरर कैंप्स इनसाइड पाकिस्तान इन अ रिटेलिएटरी अटैक आफ्टर टेररिस्ट फ्रॉम पाकिस्तान अटेम्प्टेड टू इन्फिल्ट्रेट इन कश्मीर वैली इंडियन आर्मी चीफ बिपिन रावत सेड 6 to 10 Pakistani soldiers and a similar number of terrorists had been killed in a retaliatory move.
And in the retaliatory action that our forces have taken, we have caused severe damage to terrorist infrastructure across. And let me tell you that the terrorist camps opposite Tandhar and Kirar sectors have been destroyed.
Tensions between the two nuclear-armed neighbors have flared and there has been intermittent cross-border firing since August 5, when New Delhi revoked Jammu and Kashmir's special status.
Weeks after US President Donald Trump threw out a deal with Taliban to pull American forces from Afghanistan, US Defense Secretary Mark Esper and House Speaker Nancy Pelosi made unannounced visits to Kabul on Sunday. Both the leaders separately held meetings with Afghan President Ashraf Ghani.
U.S. Defense Secretary Mark Esper arrived in Afghanistan on Sunday in a bid to bring talks with the Taliban back on track after U.S. President Donald Trump abruptly broke off negotiations last month seeking to end the United States' longest war. After his arrival in Kabul, he was greeted by Afghanistan's Defense Minister Asadullah Khalid ahead of a meeting with Afghan President Ashraf Ghani. Esper's trip to Kabul comes amid questions about the United States' commitments to allies after a sudden withdrawal of U.S. troops from northeastern Syria. Meanwhile, after a separate surprise visit to Kabul, U.S. House of Representatives Speaker Nancy Pelosi and other senior members of the Congress also held talks with the Afghan president on Sunday, focused on security, governance and economic development. Despite pulling off a safer presidential election than expected, Afghanistan looks headed for prolonged political uncertainty, with the two front-runners claiming victory before ballots are tallied and signalling they would not accept defeat.
Moving on, several student organizations under the banner of Students Educational Alliance last week held protest for days over alleged harassment and blackmail of students by some officials of the University of Balochistan. The demonstrators alleged that the vice chancellor of the varsity was responsible for the entire scandal as he was the head of blackmailers and savior of the culprits. The students asked officials to take action against the culprits. Meanwhile, vice chancellor Dr. Javed Iqbal has temporarily quit his office to let the Federal Investigation Agency complete its fair investigation into the scandal that has plagued Balochistan's oldest and most prestigious seat of higher learning.
Our goal is स्टूडेंट ऑर्गेनाइजेशन का कि यूनिवर्सिटी से तमाम फोर्सेस को हटाया जाए, तुलवा यूनियंस को बहाल किया जाए और एक कमेटी तश्कील दी जाए जो हमारे सामने हो, हमें पता चले कि कमेटी का प्रोसेस कहाँ तक चला है, वो नाम नेहाद कमेटी ना हो बल्कि वो सही से काम अंजाम दें अपना। थैंक यू।
At least 4 people were killed and about 50 injured on Sunday in clashes with police in Bangladesh over a Facebook post that offended Muslims, officials said. The clashes in the southern district of Bhola, 120 miles from the capital Dhaka, broke out when angry crowds protested against a Facebook post in which a Hindu reportedly made derogatory remarks about Prophet Muhammad. Police said the Facebook had actually been hacked and all the hackers had been detained. 4 people were killed and a policeman suffered bullet wounds during the clash, according to the superintendent of police in Bhola. Border guards and additional police have been sent to Bhola.
আমি সেটাই বলছি যে আমরা ইনকোয়ারি করব। সবই মারা হয়েছে, মানে এখানে গ্যাসও মারা হয়েছে, আমি যেটা জেনেছি গ্যাসও মারা হয়েছে, শটগানও মারা হয়েছে, সবই মারা হয়েছে এবং এই জন্যই কমিটি গঠন করা হয়েছে, বিভিন্ন কমিটি গঠন করা হয়েছে, কমিটিগুলো আরও বিস্তারিতভাবে দেখবে খুঁটিনাটি।
Bangladesh will start relocating Rohingya refugees to a flood-prone island off its coast next month as the country has been grappling with large refugee numbers. A government official said several thousand refugees have agreed to the move.
Bangladesh will start relocating Rohingya Muslims to a flood-prone island off its coast next month as several thousand refugees have agreed to move, a government official said on Sunday. Dhaka wants to move 100,000 refugees to Bhasanchar, a Bay of Bengal island, hours by boat from the mainland to ease overcrowding in its camps. Bangladesh's Cox's Bazar is home to more than 1 million Rohingya Muslims who have fled neighboring Myanmar. Mehboob Alam Talukdar, the Relief and Repatriation Commission Chief, based in Cox's Bazar, said the refugees will be shifted in phases. The plan has sparked concerns from some human rights groups because the island is remote and prone to devastation from cyclones. Densely populated Bangladesh, already grappling with large refugee numbers, had blamed Myanmar for the failure of a recent attempt to repatriate Rohingya refugees. The number of refugees has swelled since August 2017 when a Myanmar military-led crackdown that UN investigators have said was conducted with genocidal intent prompted some 730,000 Rohingyas to flee.
Sri Lanka's third international airport, the Jaffna International Airport, was declared open last week in a bid to boost tourism and development in the northern province. An Alliance Air flight landed from India's southern Chennai city, making it the first foreign flight to land in the north.
Sri Lankan President Maithripala Sirisena last week opened the country's third international airport in Jaffna in a bid to boost tourism and development in the former war-torn northern province. The Jaffna International Airport, formerly a military airport, was constructed at an approximate cost of $12 million and was funded by the governments of Sri Lanka and India. Following the opening on October 17, an ATR-72-600 aircraft of India's Alliance Air touched down on the newly constructed 950 meters runway, making it the first foreign flight to land in the north. It also marked an important moment in Sri Lanka's Tamil-majority northern province. Sri Lanka's main international airport is located on the outskirts of capital Colombo, while its second international airport is located in Matala in the southern coast. The island nation is aiming to attract 2 million tourists at the end of this year.
The 10th edition of an Indian-Maldives joint military exercise concluded in Pune city of India's Maharashtra province on Sunday. The 14-day exercise aimed to boost cooperation in counter-insurgency and counter-terrorism operations.
The 10th edition of the India-Maldives joint military exercise Equivirin 2019 concluded at the Ondh military station in Pune city of India's Maharashtra province on Sunday. The joint exercise, which is held alternatively in India and Maldives, focuses on enhancing interoperability between the two forces for carrying out counter-insurgency and counter-terrorism operations. The Maldivian contingent during the 14-day exercise was represented by Marine troops of the Maldivian National Defense Force, while the Indian side was represented by a battalion of the Mahar Regiment.
I'm sure both forces have learned from each other, not only the military aspect, but the rich culture and tradition and the way of life of the brothers in arms that you have met last 2 weeks.
The exercise has also brought to light the importance of mental and physical conditioning of soldiers and the emphasis required on realistic and effective military drills and procedures.
The participating troops expressed the exercises were important as they shared tactics which will help them in refining practices. The joint military exercise was previously held in 2018 in Maldives. Both the armies have been conducting this exercise since the year 2009.
With the Hindu Festival of Lights, Diwali, just around the corner, preparations have started in India and Nepal. Manufacturers of earthen lamps and firecrackers are all geared up and busy meeting the surge in demand.
Manufacturers in India's firecracker hub of Sivakasi has started preparing green firecrackers ahead of Diwali, the Hindu festival of lights, keeping in mind the Supreme Court safety and pollution guidelines. The Apex Court has banned the sale of firecrackers outright during the Hindu festival of lights last year as the celebrations involved bursting of firecrackers causing air pollution. Green firecrackers have lower levels of barium nitrate and create up to 30% low emission and also have lower decibel levels. Meanwhile, in neighboring Nepal's Bhaktapur, potters are busy preparing diyas or traditional earthen lamps as the festival of lights called Tihar in the Himalayan nation starts this weekend. Tihar is the second biggest festival after Dashain in Nepal, which is observed for 5 days. Potters in the country are also busy in making pala, used to light oil lamps during Tihar.
अब त्यो बनाउने त आफु समय हैन त्यो अनुसारले बनाउने हो अब यति उति भन्न सकिदैन हैन कसैले 1000 2000 5000 सम्म पनि बनाउनेहरु हुन्छ अब क्वान्टिटी अनुसारले अब म्यान पावर हुनेहरुले धेरै बनाइन्छ अब थोरै म्यान पावर हुनेहरुले थोरै बनाउँछ.
Pottery is ancestral business of people living in and around Nepal's ancient town of Bhaktapur. They have been preserving and promoting it since years. Most of the potters here have inherited it from their grandparents, while some having experienced near to half century.
Scores of athletes participated in Delhi Half Marathon on Sunday in the Indian capital, despite unhealthy air quality in the city. The pollution levels were reported to be lower as compared to last week.
Thousands of athletes ran in Delhi half marathon on Sunday despite unhealthy air quality in the Indian capital. The pollution levels were reported lower, hovering around poor, as compared to the previous very poor and hazardous levels in the past week. Ethiopian athlete Andamalak Beluhu defended his title again this year in the presence of Indian Sports Minister Kiran Rijiju.
स्वस्थ रहें और मस्त रहें और यहाँ का पॉल्यूशन वाकई में बहुत ज़्यादा बढ़ गया है तो उस पर ध्यान दे पब्लिक भी ध्यान दे रही सरकार भी दे ध्यान
The local administration in New Delhi had undertaken spraying of water mixed with safe reagent along the marathon route to help precipitation of suspended PM 2.5 and PM 10 near the earth's surface. The race was moved this year to avoid a sharp rise in pollutants during Diwali, the Hindu festival of lights, when hundreds of thousands of firecrackers are lit.
Well, that's the way it was in South Asia this evening. Before we conclude, the top stories once again. Pakistan violates ceasefire along border in India's Jammu and Kashmir. U.S. Defense Secretary, House Speaker meet Afghan President in Kabul. And 4 killed in Bangladesh over Facebook post. Now our viewers can watch the show on southasianewsline.com. You can also visit us on facebook.com/SAsianewsline and follow us on Twitter @SAsianewsline. That's all in tonight's edition. We'll see you same time tomorrow. Good night.
TAG TV brings you daily news bulletin from India. Breaking news and views from India.